In this video, I'm going to give you a little walkthrough through 4-4-J. That is the shot where the captain says, well, you know, there is a lesson to be learned from that. And that lesson is that this is a fairly simple file. So we have some easy background, which is a simple key with a little bit of masking here, and then of course the eye patch. And all these shots from this perspective from the captain are fairly similar. So this is a good example to show you the file. So if I open up 4-4-J, first I have to adjust some path because I'm working from home. So I'm going to go to a little different screen layout. So 4-4-J, and then I have to set the path to the footage. So that is here. And so this is the object track for the head. And then there is also a track for the camera, and that was a simple tripod solve with just three markers, so that was quite easy. The solve error isn't that great, but I mean, there's lots of unsharp areas, so it didn't really matter, and the camera wasn't moving that much, so it was fine. Okay, so that is the track, and then the file has several scenes. So there's 4-4-A, which was used to import some settings from a different scene. Then there is the main file where we are right now. Then there's the background and the eyeshadow. So in the main file, we have the eye patch and the holograms and a shadow catching object that is always on layer 5. Then there is the eye patch, which is on layer 2, and the hologram on layer 3. Now, I think I have to apologize because we have some kind of convention where to put stuff, but during working, I thought, well, just get stuff done and working, and then maybe later clean it up. So it's not following the official Mango convention. But in all these files, this is laid out very similar. So the eye patch is always on layer 2, holograms layer 3, and then the shadow catching object is always on layer 5. So that is that. Then of course there are some area lamps to try to get the same lighting that we have in the scene. There is a world background. And this world background is using one frame of one, I think it's a different shot. And also I have to adjust the path because I didn't download the 4Ks. So it's just an image from a sequence that is looking similar than this, just to provide some similar lighting for that. So that is the world background. Another important thing is that I've lowered the ambient occlusion distance. The default is 10, and that would give too much shadow, but 0.1 worked okay in this case. Of course, this is rendering with cycles. There's the ambient occlusion layer, there's the eye patch, hologram, and a mask layer. And the mask layer is set to this object here, which is a rough model of the eye patch. In some files, I had to animate that to make it stick a bit better, but in this case, it worked fairly well. And this is just to have something to block the ambient occlusion from also going over the original eye patch. And just using Z-mask didn't give enough control, so I've actually rendered that just to have the alpha pass of this object, and with some dilate erode I could then control that a bit better. So that is that. All these objects are tracked to one simple cube that is on this layer here. It's here. In some cases, I think I didn't put it on that layer. It might be still on layer 1, but it wouldn't render. In this case, this is a solid object, so you would see it in the render. But putting it on layer, the layer below layer 1 worked. In other cases, I have deleted only the faces, like so. So you would only have the edges and the vertices, and they don't appear in the render, so that also worked. So this has the object solver in the constraints panel, and you can still move that. If you do that, all these other objects would follow. Okay, so that is the main file, and maybe I can quickly render that with just maybe 100 samples to make it a bit faster. So here's the finished render, and Let's have a look at the stuff that we've got here. So here's the ambient occlusion layer, and I'm extracting that by using the alpha, inverting that, adding that. So you've got that. Then I'm increasing the contrast and multiplying that with the shadow pass. This is the shadow pass, and it's coming from Blender internal. And the reason for that is that the cycles shadow pass is a bit weird. It doesn't really produce nice results. And also I couldn't really control which lamp is casting a shadow, which is contributing to the shadow pass. So even if I would turn off the cast shadow button in the lamps, somehow it didn't really affect the shadow pass. So it was a bit weird. And the easier way was to just go to Blender internal. I can quickly show you what the problem is here if I turn on shadow and then just re-render this layer. So here is the shadow pass that is produced by Cycles, and it's gray. It should be white, but it's sort of gray. So I think that some other bounces are contributing to the shadow pass that shouldn't be there or that give these weird results. So I couldn't really use that. And the easier way was to just duplicate the scene with this plus sign, then creating the eyeshadow scene that is using Blender Render, and it only has one area light that is parented to that object so that the shadow doesn't change. It should be the same all the time, just to make it a bit more consistent. The lamp has to be on all the layers that are affecting that shadow pass. So I've moved it to layer 2 and 4 so that it gets the shadow from the eye patch onto the shadow catching plane here. And that is then also just creating a shadow pass, and I could use that then in the main composite. So that is here, and that is, I think, basically it. And you notice that there is no background plate, and that is because here I'm also using the cycles depth of field. The problem is that if you have a camera track and you have to scale the camera down to make it fit to the scene, then for some reason it also affects the Z depth kind of thing. So the defocus node in the compositor gave weird results, and then I ended up using the cycles depth of field because it looked better. But I didn't want it to affect the background, because the background was very nice by using bokeh blur from the compositor. That's why I've also set up the background using the same camera. So here's the background, simple plate with texture. Then there's also another plate, and that is the flare object. So this is just a radial gradient. And by setting it up like this, we could have it always on the same spot. So it gave this little glow from the upper right side. And then they are all combined here in the main composite. So up here, there is the background plate. So this is a pre-rendered thing. This is from, I think we rendered that by using 44A, which is actually still here. So this is layer 44A. Scene, and it's loading very slowly, so there's a lot of stuff in there. And because it was so slow and also was rendering very slow, we just ended up rendering one picture and then putting it in the background. So you can see this is the file, lots of stuff happening there. So there's the old lady's house, the command center, there's the whole dome and everything, all that stuff is in there. So that is taking forever to render, and that's why we just produced this one background plate and then use that, because here if the camera is not moving that much, it would work just as well. So this renders very quickly. This is the background plate, then a little bit of color correction. Here is the flare object, and it's being screened on top of that by using a different color, so that's why you have this nice glow. Here's the defocus node, even without using the Z buffer, which is not, I think this is a bit weird, this is kind of broken. Okay, so that's kind of weird, I think. I think this could be also disabled, actually. Then there is the noise. And at first we were using just this noise group, which is an image sequence of some pre-rendered noise. But, pretty late in the project, I thought that Well, the noise in the camera isn't the same in every spot of the footage. So for example, in bright areas, there's less noise than in dark areas. So that's why I ended up I was starting to use this contrast kind of thing. So this is just extracting some contrast and then using that as factor input to make the noise more here in the dark areas. In the bright areas, there wouldn't be so much noise. You've got the footage here. Oh, this is a very evil note. This has to be taken out because it was using some blur. No, don't care about that. There is the scale note, which is cropping, because originally the footage is bigger than the file. So we crop that by using the scale note. And then we are trying to improve the edges here of the green spill. So in the very beginning of the project, and especially the beginnings of the keying note, would stop a little bit too early, so you would always have this greenish edge, and then later it was improved. But before, we had to then correct that manually by using all kinds of tricks. So this is trying to improve this this area here. So by using some despill techniques, this is green edge is a bit better now. Yeah, and then we just multiply the ambient occlusion and the shadow pass onto the background. You can also see how this is being masked out by using this mask layer. So here is this proxy object for the eye patch, and with some dilate eroding and some feathering, this is then added to the shadow pass. So this is now cutting a nice feathered hole into that shadow. Invert that, and then, I mean, you could also at first I was just multiplying that over the footage, but then also later I thought, well, maybe it would be nice if the shadow would also have a similar color as the actual shadow. So I ended up multiplying some reddish color on top of that. So that's why I had to invert the shadow pass. So this is kind of the factor input for the multiply, like so. And then, oh, well, then we've got the eye patch and some noise and alpha over and the holograms, some glow, and then some extra glow in the end, some lens distortion, and that is then the finished composite. And lots of these files are set up very similar. In some files, we had to create some masking for the shadow when he's moving his hand in front of his face. In others, the object track for the head didn't really work, so in that case, I would have to go and tweak the object track for the eye patch manually. So either I would animate the parent object, or I would convert the object track to F-curves and then tweak these F-curves manually in the graph editor. In this case, it was very straightforward though, so that worked great. And yeah, basically that's 4.4J.